Hey everybody, this video is about graphing curves represented by parametric equations. This is the preferred method for representing curves in geometric modeling, and basically the only choice for representing curves in three dimensions or higher. There's a number of advantages to representing curves in this format, and in this video I hope to demonstrate a number of them. Up to this point, when we wanted to represent a curve algebraically, we typically wrote y as a function of x, or x as a function of y, or possibly use some implicit equation involving both x and y. Now we're going to separate x and y and make them both depend on some new variable called the parameter. One typical interpretation is to think of this new parameter as representing time, and then our separate equations tell us the position of each variable at any specific time. Let's consider two important reasons this is useful. Parametric representations allow us to control the position and speed of an object moving along a curve. Suppose your friend is riding on a Ferris wheel and you decide to throw a water balloon at them. It's not good enough to know that the path of your water balloon will be a parabola. You need to control the position of the balloon so it hits the wheel at exactly the right time. Another example comes from computer-aided manufacturing. Computers generate the path an industrial cutter needs to follow to cut a mold out of a steel plate. But high-speed cutters can move faster over flat regions and must slow down when they go to change directions. This is where controlling the speed is crucial to optimizing performance. Let's start with an easy example. Here we have x equals t squared plus 2t and y equals t plus 2. We can make a table of values for t, x, and y. For every choice of our parameter t, we generate an ordered pair for x and y. For instance, when t equals 0, we see x equals 0 and y equals 2. So we get the ordered pair 0, 2. When t equals 1, we get 3, 3. By generating enough points, we can begin to see the pattern formed by our curve. But of course, the parametric representation tells us much more. It tells us when we will be at a particular location. And if we think of an object moving so that it's in different locations as our parameter increases, then our new representation gives us a direction of travel and speed for moving along the curve. If we're only concerned with the shape of a corresponding curve, then a common approach that is sometimes taken is to eliminate the parameter and return to an equation involving just x and y. This is usually done by solving one of the parametric equations for t and then substituting this expression in the other equation. In our last example, it would be easy to solve our second equation for t, giving us t equals y minus 2. Then substitute this for t in our first equation for x yields x equals y minus 2 squared plus 2 times y minus 2. So we have an equation which now involves only x and y. We recognize this as a parabola and put it in our vertex form to get x plus 1 equals y minus 1 squared, which has the graph we previously observed. Let's consider another example. This time x equals t cubed minus 3t and y equals 3t squared minus 9. We plugged in several values for t and come up with the table shown below and the six ordered pairs shown in the graph. So what's the resulting graph supposed to be? Using only the ordered pairs, it's difficult to determine the shape, but since we know our graph is following a path set by t, we can use the parameter to help us move from one point to another and determine the correct graph. The parameter provides us with an ordering for the points on the graph. Imagine trying to play connect the dots without having any numbers, and consider how hard it would be to come up with the graph below if all you had was a random group of ordered pairs. By the way, notice how even a simple parametric equation can generate complex graphs. If you were to try to eliminate the parameter here, you would have a rather messy expression in x and y. Another interesting property of parametric equations is that the correspondence between curves and forms is not unique. That is, we can have different equations which result in the same graph. Consider the parametric equation given by x equals cosine t and y equals sine t. If we think of our parameter as an angle rather than time, it'd not be surprising that the graph will be just our unit circle. We can eliminate the parameter by recalling that cosine squared plus sine squared equals 1, so plugging in cosine t and sine t gives us x squared plus y squared equals 1, which is, of course, the equation for our circle of radius 1. Notice that when t equals 0, we're at the point 1, 0, and as t increases, we're moving counterclockwise until we complete the circle when t equals 2 pi. Now look at the parametric equation x equals sine 2 pi t and y equals cosine 2 pi t. We still have that cosine squared plus sine squared equals 1, so eliminating the parameter still gives us x squared plus y squared equals 1. Thus we again have the unit circle for our graph. But this time when t equals 0, we start at 0, 1, and as t increases, we move clockwise till we get back to the top of our circle when t equals 1. And finally, one more representation, this time involving rational polynomials. We can again show that x squared plus y squared equals 1. So this set of equations also generates the unit circle, but this time it takes the entire set of real numbers to move one time around the circle. So we have three representations which traverse the same graph. But notice the differences. Different forms start at different locations. Their direction can be different. The domain or time interval can be different, which of course changes the speed that we move around the circle. By modifying our equations, we can control both position and speed. Parametric equations also generalize easy to 3D and are typically the best way to represent 3D curves. All we need to do is add a new equation for z. Here's a parametric equation for a curve in three dimensions. Notice x and y are still going to follow a circular path, but as t increases, so does the height z, so our curve is spiraling upwards. We can generate other conic curves parametrically using the hyperbolic trig functions. If you're not familiar with the hyperbolic cosine, pronounced cosh, or the hyperbolic sine, pronounced sinh, you can use the definition shown here, that cosh of t is equal to e to the t plus e to the minus t over 2, while sinh of t is equal to e to the t minus e to the minus t over 2. These functions have properties very similar to cosine and sine, and in particular, using the definition shown here, it's very easy to show that cosh squared minus sinh squared equals 1. So if we have parametric equations like x equals h plus a cosh t and y equals k plus b sinh t, then we can solve these for cosh and sinh to get cosh of t equals x minus h over a, and sinh of t equals y minus k over b. Now plugging these back into our identity cosh squared minus sinh squared equals 1 just yields the general equation for a hyperbola centered at the point hk, with curves opening in the x direction. This is in fact why they are called hyperbolic trig functions. Our next example involves a curve called a cycloid, which aside from being an interesting curve will help us show another important property of parametric equations. The cycloid is made by following the path of a point on a circle as the circle is rolled along a linear path. If you've ever played with a spiral graph as a kid, you'll have seen many variations on this pattern. So let's consider a circle of radius r rolling along the x-axis. We can follow the path of a point P starting at the origin, and we'll use theta, the angle of rotation of our circle, as our parameter. You can see from this picture that as we rotate our circle through some angle, that the x value of our point P will just be the distance OT minus QP. That is, we can go forward to T and then back to X. OT just represents how far we've rolled, which will be the same as the arc length. The arc length for a circle of radius R is just R times theta. Now, because triangle PQC is a right triangle, PQ over R is just the same as sine theta. Replacing OT with R times theta and PQ with R times sine theta, we have a formula for x in terms of theta. Similarly, y equals ct minus cq. Ct is just the radius of our circle, which is r, and cq over r is the cosine of theta. So substituting these values gives us that y equals r minus r cosine theta. This gives us a parametric set of equations which will generate our cycloid curve. The important thing to observe here is that using parametric equations allows us to treat x and y separately from each other. This can help with curves where x and y may depend on different factors. For instance, if you're firing a cannonball from a cannon, the height or y value may be affected by gravity, while the distance in the x direction may be impacted by wind speed. Finally, I want to finish with an example from the world of geometric modeling. We'll start with a parametric equation for a line going through two points, x1, y1, and x2, y2. The general equation is given here, x equals x1 plus x2 minus x1t, and y equals y1 plus y2 minus y1t. It's easy to see that if t equals 0, we're at the point x1, y1, and if t equals 1, we reach the point x2, y2. An easy way to verify this is to solve both equations for t and eliminate the parameter, and you can see we just get the standard two-point form of a line in x and y. Let's find the parametric equation of the line going through 1, 2, and 8, 5. If we let 1, 2 be x1, y1, and 8, 5 be x2, y2, then x equals 1 plus 8 minus 1t, which is 1 plus 7t. Similarly, y equals 2 plus 3t. If you work with vectors before, you might recognize that x2 minus x1, y2 minus y1 is just the vector pointing from the first point to the second point. Another thing to notice is that because there's no division or slope involved, the parametric equation for a line works for any line, including vertical ones where we normally have trouble because the slope is infinite. Now suppose we were to rearrange the terms of our linear equation slightly to see exactly how t is influencing each individual coordinate. In this form, we have two functions of t, which start out working with one coordinate and then blend over to the second coordinate. The pair of expressions 1 minus t and t are called blending or basis functions. We can extend this idea to three coordinates as follows. Create a linear blend between the first two points, then a linear blend between the second two, and then finally a linear blend between the two linear blends. You can see here that we get three blending functions, 1 minus t squared, 2t times 1 minus t, and t squared, for the three coordinates x1, x2, and x3. Continuing this process, we get that the n blending functions to use for n coordinates are precisely the terms of the binomial expansion, 1 minus t plus t raised to the n minus 1 power. These functions are known as the Berenstein basis functions after Sergei Berenstein, who first wrote about them in 1912. But they rose to a greater prominence in 1962 when Pierre Bézier, a mathematician who was working for Renault Car Company, used these blending functions to create parametric spline curves that approximate the shape of a collection of points. These spline curves are called Bézier curves. So suppose we want to find the Bézier curve that approximates negative 2, 0, 0, 2, and 2, 0. Since we have three points, we need to use the three blending functions, 1 minus t squared, 2t times 1 minus t, and t squared. For the x equation, we just blend the three x values, and for the y equation, we blend the three y values. This gives us x equals 4t minus 2, and y equals negative 4t squared plus 4t. The graph of this parametric equation is shown on the right. So in summary, parametric equations allow us to control position and velocity of a point moving along our curve. They allow us to separate how we handle x and y, which can result in easier equations, and they help us by providing order to the points that we generate. Hopefully this video has given you enough information to get started working with parametric equations. You can see more of my math videos at www.mathforeveryone.info. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks for watching. Fucking on a thing.